Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here, Tropical Plant Party. How's everybody doing? I hope you're good. I am great. It is an unseasonably beautifully warm day here, and I thought, let's talk about hibiscus. More specifically, I should say, moving hibiscus indoors. Now, I meant to do this video a couple of weeks ago. I'm just sorry, I forgot to get it out and done. I know for some people in northern states, it's like that moment has passed and things have gotten kind of cool and chilly where you live. The tropical hibiscus, this is one that I have had a fair amount of requests on to get a video out for everyone where we can talk about moving them inside and then growing them as a houseplant during the winter months. And I'm gonna go ahead and later on in the video just generally talk about growing them as a houseplant period. But the main focus here is what needs to be done to take them from being grown outdoors to indoors. Now, here in front of me, I have my tropical hibiscus. That's kind of a broad statement. There are several different types of tropical hibiscus. This is a Hibiscus rosa sinensis. The variety of this one is called Chatty Cathy. There are lots and lots and lots of different varieties, different leaf shapes, flower forms, growth habits, but just specifically this is about the tropical varieties. Most common, you know what I'm saying? For everyone out there who lives north of zone 9, anywhere where you have winter temperatures that consistently drop below 40 degrees, I mean anywhere where you might have a couple of frosts per year, then you're like me and you have to move these indoors. They don't like those cold temperatures. They grow their best with warmth. So moving them indoors can be a little bit complicated just because they tend to throw a fit when they get moved around. And it's really common. I get questions during the winter time a lot from people about if their hibiscus is dying and, you know, the way it's behaving differently indoors versus outdoors. And it's because they need to be treated differently indoors versus outdoors. So go ahead and get into all that. Oh, and a quick disclaimer, you may notice this one, the growth is very wonky on it, and that's because this is one where if you watch my videos back in like, I don't know, May or June, I have a very, very, very large potted palm tree that got blown over in a storm and just absolutely smashed this poor plant. But I decided to use this one in the video, even though I have lots and lots and lots of hibiscus plants, this is the only one that's in bloom right now. So I thought, well, I'll just go ahead and use this one. So no, not a perfect looking plant, but I mean, come on, most plants really aren't that perfect looking. Instagram and whatnot can be misleading in that sense. Still healthy, that's the main thing here. So for me, when it's time to start moving my hibiscus indoors, there are a few things I like to do. One of those things is, first and foremost, I give them a big cutback, which I'm not going to do right now because I probably still have a few weeks of growing with these outdoors. And they're all in bud. This has lots of flower buds on it. I'd like to get to enjoy that while I can. But let's move in a little bit closer and kind of talk about the cutback process. As you can see here, this one has a lot of new green growth on it. And I don't really expect that to do much during the winter months inside. Unless you have a really, really warm environment to keep them, like a sunroom or a four-season greenhouse where temperatures are staying above, say, 77 with lots of light all winter, then these are going to more rest during the winter than give much growth and much in the way of flowers. So because when a hibiscus is being moved into the house, they kind of enter a mode of, like I just said, they kind of just want to rest. That's why it's good to get out some shears, some pruners, make sure they're sterilized and clean, and you can start giving them a very heavy cutback. Some people will even cut them back, like, I mean, just a few inches from the main growth. So on this plant specifically, if I were to go ahead and give that a really heavy cutback, then I would probably take off pretty much all of the green growth that's on here that doesn't have any type of wood on it. I want to go in anything that's dead that needs to be removed. There's no reason to keep that around. It's just going to attract pests and things you don't want in the house. So yeah, see, things like that, that can go. So for me, pretty much from like right here, probably to about here, that kind of dome area, that's what I'd be pruning off. And no, you don't have to do this. The reason that I like to do things this way is because, sorry to be redundant, but when they get moved inside, they're just not getting the same conditions they are outdoors. They're not going, oh, I really want to grow. Now, the day lengths are a lot shorter, depending on where you live. You could live in an equatorial climate, but maybe have a higher elevation where you still can't go outside all year. I don't know. I'm just talking about, like, for me in my area, there's not a ton of light. So even if you have a sunroom, any type of solarium, really bright, warm space for them, unless they're going to be getting 6 hours or more probably of like really bright intense light, they're just going to kind of want to chill out, especially with the cooler temperatures that are inside. And all of this up here is growth that needs to be supported. You can't really support it very well when it's not getting the light and the warmth and everything it needs to keep going. You get it? That's also why it's really common when these get moved inside to notice some leaf yellowing. This one's not yellow, I'm just saying. The leaves, the foliage will start to yellow. It will fall off. And it's also really common when these get moved inside to have the flower buds start to shrivel and fall off. It's just like I said, they throw a fit. A drastic change going from outdoors to indoors. Okay, and then after everything's been pruned back, I like to come in with my hose, a decent amount of pressure, and wash everything off. Get the tops, the bottoms of the foliage. The point here is I'm trying to knock off any pests or insects, even dust. You need to give a visual inspection, of course. Assuming that that visual inspection's been done, then that's when to come in and spray them down and get all the stuff off of them. And then once everything's been cleaned off really well, flushed thoroughly, that's a good time to go ahead and give them a good spray down with some neem or some type of like a soapy solution. You can use like a Dawn dish soap, something like that. Usually a like teaspoon to a gallon of warm water. Sometimes a tablespoon's fine. That's going to help smother anything that's left behind before you move it into the house. You can do those things indoors too. That's up to you. But neem and the dish soap, peppermint oil, and there are lots of things you can do indoors that are more safe. I personally just think neem is a little bit pungent to have in the house. Some people like the smell. I don't really care for it, but it might be necessary to establish some sort of regimen when it comes to spraying with soaps and things like that in the house too, because of pests. So when bringing them indoors, there are a few different things you can do. I like to cool store mine. So instead of, even though I have a nice, warm, brightly lit grow space to keep them in my house where I keep temperatures in the upper 70s and low 80s most of the time, I still find them just easier to keep as far as pests are concerned if they're not in a state of active growth. So I keep them on my cool side, the cooler area of my grow area, where temperatures range from like probably more like 55 to 60 something, somewhere in there. And I only water them when they are bone dry. They're not getting a lot of light. The temperatures are cool, so nothing's telling them that they need to be growing and that they need water. Do have some larger hibiscus, just like standard forms. The Seminole Pink is one in particular that's too large for me to keep in my cool area. So with that one, it stays on the warmer side under very bright lights, and it gets watered just like all the other plants do, which is fairly frequently. However, I'm gonna go ahead and just assume that most people watching this maybe haven't converted their garage into a very warm and humid tropical grow area, right? That's not normal. I know, I'm not normal, I'm weird, I get it. And I grow these just in the house. Under normal conditions, my house is generally between 68, 72. I don't have any windows that get a lot of sunlight. So still, because of that, I still prefer to grow them more in the cool form, where I will find a spot that's, it's not very bright, a cool area, like a basement might be a good place to put them. Now, they'll still need supplemental lighting, because even though they're not in an active state of growth, they're still going to want light. They still need to photosynthesize. These aren't really going to be deciduous, though they can be. It's not necessarily ideal for them. And I mean deciduous, deciduous in the sense that they're pre-programmed to drop leaves at a certain time of year and to go dormant and rest. They can do that, but they're not programmed to do it. It's more of a defense mechanism, kind of a survival thing when they do that. That's how I would handle them in the house if you don't have a really, really bright window to put them in, where they'll get at least, I'd say, 4.5 to 6 hours of intense light. That's when it's good to grow them the cool way. Recap of the cool growing, 55 to 65 degrees, somewhere in there. They're still going to need light, just not like super, super intense light. So I would still say at least probably a good 4 hours of light you can supplement with grow lights. That's totally fine. And every grow light's different, so you just kind of have to follow the manufacturer's specifications for where you need to place them in relation to the plant and how long you want to keep that light on, because it's going to vary from the wattage. With LEDs hitting the market over these last few years, it has really kind of scrambled things up as far as just being able to say use this light for this amount of time. That's not the case anymore. There's different wattages and different lenses, and there's a lot of variability. Remember, let them dry out in between waterings. That's important. They'll just get nasty and rot. No fertilizing, nothing like that. Let them chill. Now, if you want to move them in and keep them somewhat growing and hopefully maybe still get some flowers out of them, then that's when they need to be above 70, ideally, and getting all that light like I was talking about before, bright, intense light. And If that's the case, if you have those conditions and you can grow them that way, then you don't necessarily need to do the heavy cutback in everything like I talked about in the beginning, but still expect them to drop some leaves and maybe some flower buds when they get moved into the house. It's okay, it's not dying. If that happens within the first few weeks of moving them inside, that's not usually the plant dying, it's them just really being divas. To grow them in a manner that would keep them in an active state of growth with nice full foliage and still producing flowers, you would need very warm conditions, way above 70. I'd say you want to be upper 70s into the lower to mid 80s, a good amount of humidity, a good amount of airflow, and by a good amount of humidity, I mean like 40% and up at least, in a minimum of 6 hours of bright, bright, bright light. Distance from the windows does make a big difference. You don't want them to be so close that it's going to be really cold and drafty. If you have really cold winters like I do, then I wouldn't keep them too close to my windows because, like I said, they're drafty. But I would still want to keep them within 2 to 3 feet probably of the windows because the further away they go, the less intense that light's going to be. I will water them more frequently if they're being grown this way, but still not very much. I'm still probably going to let the soil dry out maybe 50% of the way in between waterings. This is assuming that they're at like 70 degrees, somewhere around there. I'm talking Fahrenheit, not Celsius. That would be very, very, very hot. I still will not be fertilizing them in these conditions. Not, like I said, unless it's you got like a tropical environment to put them in your house somehow or greenhouse, then they don't need to be fertilized. That's going to tell the plant to grow, even though the light's not telling it to grow. The auxin's not going on there. Almost misleads a hormone situation plants have for growing. And then you can end up with some really gangly, just weird looking growth. And just like with any typical houseplant, I would want to make sure to rotate the plant every so often, probably every couple of weeks to maintain nice even growth. And to help cut back on pests, this is a plant that I like to make sure that the foliage does get blasted with water even when it's being grown inside. If you are able to, this is kind of saying a lot, sort of a big thing. You don't have to do this, but it can be very helpful to the plant to go ahead, take them to a shower. Maybe you have a large mud sink, something like that. Cover the soil up, which I'm trying to get in focus here. Cover the soil up so that water doesn't get in there. You can wrap it in plastic, maybe some foil, something like that, and give it a nice shower, the tops and the bottom of the foliage. If that can be done like once a month to every other month with the plant, it can really make a big, big difference on cutting back on the pests. Whitefly and spider mites can be really common on the hibiscus, particularly when they're being grown indoors. The lack of airflow, the lack of humidity, those are things that both of those insects really enjoy. So being able to give them that wash makes a big difference. Otherwise, like I mentioned before, using a diluted soap, neem oil, peppermint oil, a whole bunch of different things you can do in the house as far as sprays goes that are safe and also help smother those pests and those insects. But just don't be surprised if this is sitting in a place with stale air, low humidity, and it's just not getting any water on the foliage like ever. Don't be surprised if pests show up, especially spider mites. So if the air is really dry, having a humidifier near the plant can make a big difference. Having other plants around the plant that maybe like more water than the hibiscus will need during the winter months, that can help hold in humidity and create a nice moist environment for them. But still, I think it's really helpful with them to give them a good wash every couple of months. Because doing that isn't just going to help keep pests off of the foliage, it's going to help remove, my sprinklers turned on, they kind of startled me a little bit. It's also going to help keep dust off of the foliage so they can photosynthesize better. There's not a barrier between the chlorophyll in the foliage and the UV rays that are coming in through the windows or the grow lights, however you're growing them. Of course, can go ahead and bring them in and try growing them the warm way first, as in like, you know, just keeping them in a place that gets a lot of light, seeing how they do, and if that doesn't work out, you can still go ahead, give them a cutback, and move them someplace cool where they just kind of chill throughout the winter months. And there are so many different varieties of the tropical hibiscus of the Rosa sinensis. There are some that I have noticed perform much better indoors. My Seminole Pink, which is a really common variety, I have always noticed does wonderfully during the winter months. It still throws a fit, and it'll drop some foliage and some buds when I move it inside. And that could be maybe avoided a little bit more if I were to move them into darker locations for like, let's say, like reduce it by an hour of light every week leading up to when I move them inside. I still feel like they would probably throw a fit and drop their foliage, so I don't really bother with it. But that's kind of a good thing to do when moving any houseplant inside, is to slowly reduce their light and their watering a few weeks before you move them in. That's hardening them off, get them ready to experience the indoor conditions as much as possible. It's just less of a shock when you move them in. Another variety that I have, I wish these were in flower right now so I could show them to you. Usually they're just not. They're budded and ready to go with another set of flowers here in a few days. Let me get this video out now for people who are moving their plants in right now. But yeah, another variety that I've noticed does well when I move it inside, it's called Sex on the Beach. I didn't name it that. Don't come for me. I'm sorry. And Tequila Sunrise, they look very similar. They might be the same and just from different growers. I don't know, because like I said, the flowers on them look very, very similar, but those two in particular I've noticed do much better than some of my others when I move them in. This one right here, the Chatty Cathy, I haven't even attempted to overwinter this one before, so I can't say really how this one does in the house. I just have to wait and see. There are some commercially grown, like mass-produced hibiscus, like the Seminole Pink and just the Mr. President, like this, the regular red tropical hibiscus that we see at all the big box stores. Sometimes those are going to do a lot of blooming the first year that you have them, and then you'll bring them inside, overwinter them in one of the different ways I've talked about, or however works for you, and then you may notice that they're not doing much the next year. Don't know why, but sometimes there seems to be something with these mass-produced ones that are really, really common, where once they've overwintered indoors, they don't necessarily have as much vigor to their flowering after they've been inside for a season. Haven't noticed that with my Seminole Pink. Didn't flower a ton this year, but I also repotted it. They don't need to be repotted too terribly often. Hibiscus, like, they kind of like to be somewhat root bound. They still like a rich soil, but it needs to drain well, have sharp drainage. That's all more like probably springtime video stuff about when you first purchase your hibiscus. That just was leading up to my next point though, which is that this is not the time to repot them. Don't do it. There's no reason to do it this time of year, because they're not going to adjust to being in a larger pot. They're not going to put out their roots if they're being grown in cooler conditions. If you have, like, I'd say at least 2 months before you move them in, then maybe give it a shot, but I just wait. Might mean you have to water them a little bit more often, but you're not going to have to deal with water settling around the root zone instead of going into the root zone and then the plant basically just dehydrating and dying. You need to really be able to saturate their pots. They need to be able to get really, really wet when you want them to root out into their new pots. That's hard to do when you're moving them into the house, just because, I mean, it's so much water going everywhere. You'd have to, like, basically set them in a big bucket to do the watering every time, and I don't seems too complicated to me, but to each his own. You can give it a try if you feel it's absolutely necessary. Again, maybe you have a really, really warm, brightly lit area where these are going to keep growing and not skip a beat. It's not likely, but those conditions do exist. Some people have areas where they can do that with their plants, which is fantastic. And then, I don't know, you do you. Maybe that'll work out okay. As far as general households conditions go, don't do it. All right, and lastly, sort of, the most common question I get about hibiscus and keeping them indoors is, will it still flower? And the answer is a little bit tricky and not direct, because sometimes they will. Like I mentioned, different varieties are different. They have different types of vigor to them. The Seminole Pink, it usually gives me a few flowers during the wintertime, and that's in a very warm grow space. When I have grown that in the house, I still would get a few flowers, but they would be very, very small. Cooler conditions tend to give hibiscus smaller flowers, period. And then in the house, probably going to be the same situation, especially since you really don't want to be fertilizing them, so they're not going to be getting their, like, high potassium fertilizers that they enjoy, and phosphorus fertilizers, which help get them blooming. It's not something they want in the winter when they're inside and the light's not very intense and the day lengths are shorter and everything. So chances are you won't see a lot of flowers, not the flowers like you would see when growing them outside, but if they're getting enough light and they're happy, they'll still flower for you. Just don't think that you're doing something wrong if it doesn't. These don't have to be covered in flowers at all times to mean that the plant is healthy. That varies from variety to variety. There are some where you can expect them to just bloom and bloom and bloom and bloom and bloom, but in general, that's not always the case.
usually a hibiscus will bloom for a while, then rest for a few weeks, then bloom for a while, then rest for a few weeks.
And then when in the house, they might bloom a little bit, and that might be all you get all season long. It just depends on the plant and your growing conditions. If you're determined to grow them in the home and still have flowers on them, then it's going to be more of the warmer method like I was talking about, at least 70 to 75 degrees during the day, at least 6 hours of bright, bright, bright light on the plant. If it's the active growing season, meaning that the day lengths are longer and the light's going to be different when it's an active growth too. The active growing season, typically, depending on where you live, like April through September, somewhere in there, mid to late spring through late summer. That's what I'm talking about. Then you will still want to fertilize them, but just monthly. You can use an all-purpose like Osmocote. That's a slow release, works fine. You can use a liquid fertilizer. I really like with my hibiscus to use fertilizers that are actually meant for hibiscus. I don't really recommend a specific one, unfortunately. I'm sorry, but people are all over the world who watch these videos. Oh, and the last thing that's very important to note here, if growing these inside, or actually growing a hibiscus period, you have them in a pot, maybe there's a drainage dish underneath them, make sure that the bottom of that pot's not in contact with water, because that will wick back up and can cause problems with rot. They want to drain. There are lots of different types of hibiscus. There are some that grow in marshy, wet, soggy conditions, but the tropical Rosa sinensis, that's not one of them. So it's usually a good idea to have some pebbles or something in the tray to help hold the pot up above where water will settle in it. That's a general rule to follow no matter what time of year and where you're growing them. So that's the two, really three different ways that I like to go about explaining how I overwinter hibiscus, the different ways. I know that the third way, the like tropical warm grow space, not the most applicable, but the other two, fairly common. You know, you may not have a cool place to keep them, and then you may not have a place that's warm enough. 70 degrees and up with lots and lots of sun, those conditions just may not exist in every household. They likely don't. Not everybody has bright, sunny, warm places to keep their plants. Maybe you have them, but there's like a vent nearby or a door nearby that's gonna let in like, you know, minus 20 degree air every time it opens during the winter. They're not gonna want that. They don't like cold drafts. They don't like drafts, period. There's just so many variables, but that's kind of a broad look at the basics. Another long, lengthy video, but as you know, if you're new here, maybe you don't, I always like to explain the why and the how and not just the what. It just makes things so much easier, I think, to be able to learn and get all the details, because then you can use your own deductive reasoning and logic and help troubleshoot things. Like I said, if you're growing this indoors and it's been dropping leaves and just looking terrible, don't necessarily blame yourself. Maybe it's being overwatered. Maybe it's just been moved in. If it's just been moved in, then it's probably just throwing a fit. Cut back on watering, of course, and give it time. Really important. Give them time. Usually they will flush out with new growth. It's going to be small, little growth, but typically that's how they react to being moved into the house. There are a lot of variables to keep in mind, and there are lots of different ways to grow them indoors. I'm just talking about my personal experience and what I've learned from other people as far as growing them in the house, overwintering them more specifically. As always, any input is always appreciated. Comment down below. Tips, tricks, suggestions. It's helpful. Everybody who goes down in the comment section can see those things, and we can all learn together, make a nice productive plant nerd environment over here. I will have updates as these start to bloom, my other ones and whatnot, up on my Instagram, so you can follow my social media. It's all linked down below in the description if you want to see those things. It might make it into the next garden tour. I'm not really sure. It kind of depends on how the weather behaves and if I have to do a lot of scrambling to get things inside. Hopefully that won't be the case this year. And if you haven't already and you'd like to, you can give the video a thumbs up. It makes a really big difference for the videos and for the channel. I do appreciate it. Thank you so much for doing so. And subscribe as well and hit that notification bell. It's uploaded multiple times a week. And that way you'll know when new videos come out. And I truly hope everybody's doing well, having a great day, a great life. Everything's just going beautifully for you. And I'm sorry I didn't have a more pretty plant to use for this video. I think the flowers on this one are just stunning, but you know, this is the one that got flattened, so the growth is kind of wonky. I just didn't want to use one that wasn't in flower. At least there's a flower to look at on this one. And of course, as always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye bye.